Namaskar and welcome to all. As a start, I'd like to thank all the eminent speakers who have set aside their very precious time to be with us today. And of course, all the participants and all the attendees for coming in such large numbers to this first Zoom webinar that we are doing from the Center for Soft Power. We are at a time in the world now when kindness, compassion, caring and empathy are in a great need. That's the need of the hour with the present situation that the world is facing. And what better way to build this other than the arts? You will hear soon from all the other speakers about how important an art education is to build these qualities. And if we look at, I can tell you about Indian art. If you look at Indian art, it also brings you very close to Mother Nature, whether it's Indian performing arts, visual arts, or even literature. It brings you very close to Mother Nature. For example, even the notes of our music are related or representative with animals. So Sa or Shajja is represented by a peacock. You have Ra or Ri. Rishabha, which is represented by a bull, and then there's Nishada with an elephant, and you have Daivata, which is a cuckoo, and so on and so forth. So while educating children or even the or anybody for that matter, this closeness to Mother Nature must come, because that is what brings this sense of oneness, which is also a very great part of our heritage and culture and our arts, which identifies entire creation as one. You know, the much bandied word now is Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, and that is what our arts does to us. So the whole objective of this is to make people understand the importance of an art education, because somewhere in between, and you know, when I listen to policy makers, they go about with this whole thing about economics is the first thing, arts is for a satisfied stomach. I doubt there'll be a satisfaction in life if art is not a part of life. Arts is absolutely a necessity. It should become as important as any other subject in the curriculum. It's not a co-curricular activity as it is presently in many of the schooling and college systems. So our whole exercise now, and maybe we will be having another session on the 2nd of May, is about how to actually establish that art is very, very important to life. Be it music, dance, visual art, literature, any of these arts that bring the finer emotions in a human being are very important. I would like to thank Dr. Rupa Vasudevan, Chancellor of West University, for accepting to be a moderator for this session. So a lot of the work has been, she is shouldering. So Rupa, you can take over now.
Thank you, Vijayalakshmi Akka. I call her Akka because she's more than an elder sister to me, always been a mentor and guide to me throughout this journey of my being an educator. Thank you very much for inviting me as a moderator here. I'll just take 4 minutes to set the context before we move into the speakers and understand their insights. Well, we all know that art is imperative. It builds concentration, it builds a certain level of accountability, there is creativity that comes with it, there is expression, there is confidence. But as an educator since about 20 years, my challenge has always been that art has been treated as extracurricular. Rightly said so by Vijayalakshmi Akka, who's also the director of Soft Power. We've been told right from the time I was a child, probably it's worsened now, because we are now in India a $2.25 trillion economy, and we are moving towards a $5 trillion economy by 2025. Our priorities are really not blended learning. Our priorities are not really bringing in the art and the hybridized learning mechanisms that was there in the version one of the Indian education system. We go back to the Gurukula system where it was a very, very, very high quality learning that students used to have. It was 1:1 teacher-student ratio. there was the student could learn anything under the sun, right from zoology to astronomy. And he had wide choices of entering and exiting subjects the way he wished to. Now, this by far was not a scalable model, obviously, when the British invaded India. They built a curriculum around standardization. Now, what is standardization? In standardization, they wanted to churn out, literally, in a factory where they could have thousands of accountants, thousands of menial laborers. And that's exactly what they did to our education system. They completely rogered it to standardizing it. Now, with standardization came, while we were standardizing and while the British rule continued, after the independence, 70 years of our version 2 of the education system has been high enrollment rates, from 7 to 17% that we were during the independence to today at 80%. India has achieved 80% literacy rate, where there are 8 million students passing out of the higher education every year, which by far makes our education system and the university system the largest in the world, even ahead of China. Now, this is a factory model. And in this factory model, we churn out about 240 million students every year. Now, what happens to these students? Of course, many of them are employed, but the rest of them who are not, they find solace in depression. They have issues with accountability. They have issues with being proactive. They have issues in progressing in their general life, personal life, even besides their career. So this is what we are churning out. Now, is this the time to speak about quality now? Yes. After 70 years, the new government has now launched a new curricular and pedagogical structure, which will be launched in 2021. It's called the New Education Policy. And it's trying to receive a lot of these, a lot of advice and advice from the think tanks such as Center for Soft Power, and there are many other think tanks and universities and institutions that are giving and delivering their point of view, and they are ensuring that the national education policy becomes the more robust one, where flexibility will be the one point of pedagogy that will be followed. 2021 has earmarked 33,000 crores by the Indian government for flexi learning. And now is the time that we come together, we tell the government, we come out with newer teaching pedagogies which will help our students becoming an all-rounder. The challenge is huge, but it is possible because of the scale. So today we are having the part one of this session, where we are going to talk about blended learning, hybridized learning, where art will become and form an important structure and not extracurricular in our core curriculum systems. The general format of conference today is that we will have 10-minute speaking time after I introduce the speaker. And once we are done with the speakers, we will have our special participants speaking for about 3 minutes. And in the end, we will have question answers, but only those questions will be taken which have been emailed or will come on the screen right now in the Zoom chat. So we start with our first speaker for the day.